Yesterday, the government announced that New Zealand will be repatriating Suhayra Aden and her two children from immigration detention in Turkey, where they've been held since February. As you'll recall, New Zealand is dealing with this issue because Australia simply walked away from it. That's despite 26-year-old Aden moving with her family to Australia when she was only six and living there until she travelled to Syria in 2014 on an Australian passport. So she was a dual citizen of both countries with far greater ties to Australia. But after she was caught with her children trying to enter Turkey from Syria, with Turkish authorities saying she was a member of Islamic State or connected to them, Australia revoked her citizenship and locked the door. Classy Australia. They are not Turkey's responsibility, and with Australia refusing to accept the family, that makes them ours, Jacinda Ardern said. And of course, they can't be left stateless. So she's coming to New Zealand. The question is, how do you ensure the successful reintegration of someone like this back into, well, normal society? Zooming in from Waiheke to share his insights. We're really delighted to welcome back to Breakfast Christian and Muslim relations expert and author of Religious Extremism, Rejecting Diversity, Professor Douglas Pratt. Professor Pratt, it's so nice to have you with us. Thank you. I just want to ask you, and I guess I'm asking your opinion here, is New Zealand doing the right thing?
Absolutely. No problem with that at all. You outlined the raw case completely clearly there, but no, there's no choice at one level. At the other level, to the extent that a decision has been made, so implying some possible choice, I believe the right choice has been made. Mm. She is a New Zealand citizen. Her kids deserve a break.
Yes. And I guess the idea is that if you return somebody to normal society, that they will have ties and connections. What makes this even more complex than usual is that if she has ties and connections, they are way more likely to be in Australia. But Australia has completely abrogated its moral responsibility by walking away here. So she might know people in Australia. She's less likely to know people in New Zealand. How do we integrate her?
That's the critical question. I mean, from if you like, what Australia has done is a 501A, you might say, treated her in that kind of sense of we want to get rid of her because we don't like what she does or whatever. But I think in this particular case, the good news is because she is a Muslim and there is a very strong Muslim community in New Zealand, an extremely good Muslim Women's Association with some excellent people in it, I'm quite sure that if the right connections are made into that community, whether it be in Auckland, Wellington, Christchurch, but one of those main centres, then she will get the support and the tools, we like, for habilitation. So it's not as if she's being rehabilitated in our society. She's not been a member of our society. She might be a citizen, but she's not a member of our society. So she has to be habilitated into New Zealand society as a Muslim. And so that also brings into play what in the field we refer to as, counter-radicalisation programs. Now, I don't know if there's been any such program in New Zealand, but they're straightforward enough to do, which is, in other words, a re-education program. Mm. Because by being enamoured of ISIS, she's got caught up with a very narrow and extremist interpretation and application of her own faith. Now, there are many, many different ways of unpacking that and actually normalizing her into what you might say ordinary Islam, which is, has its values on peace with all and on its ability to work with other people, not to attack them. So that kind of habilitation process, I think, can easily take place in the context of New Zealand. You only have to look at, how Muslim leadership reacted in Christchurch, both in 2019 and since, to see how the strong values there of humanity, of justice, of cooperation, of owning and proudly owning their status as Muslims of New Zealand. And that's what I would hope for her.
Boy, this is sounding possible. And I like the fact that you're talking about de-radicalising. I guess the question is, how do people get radicalised in the first place? But the radicalisation is, we saw the Royal Commission and the judge in the mosque murder case describe exactly how people get radicalised, right? They get exposed to the shooter, Brenton Tarrant, got more and more radicalised by exposing himself to white supremacist hatred online. This is just how this stuff happens. I guess the question here is, what role can the rest of us play? And so if she's going to arrive and live amongst us, and we presume that the agencies who are responsible for this stuff will keep an eye on her and making sure everything's going okay. But how can the rest of us not inflame the sense of her as an other?
Well, there is a straightforward answer to that, which is to back off Islamophobia, to back off our within our society from all sorts of angles. There is still a strong line of antipathy towards Islam and Muslims. It comes out, you know, more subtly perhaps, but it's there. I mean, the Muslim community have been complaining of it and noting it for some time. And I think that ties into the whole debate about hate speech that's coming up and vis-a-vis religion. What is appropriate to say in terms of critique as against what is inappropriate in terms of slandering and putting down and making people feel like they are not welcome. Our country presents itself and is perceived by people who come into our society as being tolerant and open, which is true to a degree, to a large degree, really, compared with many other countries. But we still have our underbelly of you know, rejection, shall we say, that can manifest in so many ways. And so the key will be not just in relation to her, but in relation to her community, that she feels she's part of a community that is accepted within New Zealand. Because one of the reasons why so many young people like her, I mean, she was a teenager when she went, got hooked into ISIS was their seductive kind of propaganda about this was the true Islam that was going to, it was almost like a utopian vision. And some of the propaganda that I've seen some years ago really underscored that. But the reality was quite different when they got into it. The reality was quite different. And you know, my pick is that she's been well and truly traumatized and she's got some, you know, incredible deep experiences to resolve.
Professor Douglas Pratt, we so appreciate you joining us this morning. Calm, level-headed, empathetic wisdom from you. Thank you. We're very grateful. It's lovely to talk to you, beaming in from Waiheke.
Thank you.